start with the thing. What exactly the origins of cinema? You all know about the Lumiere brothers. They filmed. They filmed this train entering a station, workers leaving factory. Okay. They basically recorded a reality. This is the basic thing of cinema, was a recording of reality. Right. Now, a little later, the Lumieres exhibited their films and making money on it. And there was this man called Méliès, and you might have heard this story. Have you heard of the story of Méliès? That he was one of the early invitees to the festival. He was a magician, and he decided to film reality, film road scene, street scene. At some point, the film in his camera jammed. When he was filming, what was in front of him was a bus or a car or something. When he recommenced shooting, there was a hearse in front. Okay, hearse carrying dead bodies. Okay, it was in front of him. So when he started filming and the thing was screened, developed and screened, what it looked like was that a car had turned into a hearse, that men had turned into women. It looked like that. Okay, because of the completely accidental cut in this film. You must have heard, this is a story which has been repeated so many. So the question is, what it meant to him was that cinema is a very good, has a great capacity for creating illusion. Okay, this is a fundamental thing. Now, why does the cinema have a capacity for illusion is that you take what you see on the screen to be reality. So when something happens and you see a trick of some sort in the film, that trick is seen as an illusion rather than a trick. Okay, so this is why cinema became a key thing for creating illusion. It became a vehicle for creating illusion. Later on, of course, what happens is that because of this, they said that Lumiere is the father of documentary cinema, and Méliès was the father of fantasy and the father of a fantasy and illusion in cinema. Godard, of course, Godard was a smart aleck, so Godard's thing was that Lumiere was actually the fantasist, because creating the illusion of reality on the screen, where he was documenting the capacity of cinema for creating illusion, what he said. Like all of Godard's statements, they should be taken with a barrel full of salt. Okay. Now the basic thing is that cinema, because of this, the cinema created as an art form, it developed as an art form. What is the difference between the cinema as an art form and theater and say something like literature? What is the basic difference? See, the basic difference is that literature is made with man-made objects. It's a words, right? Words are man-made objects. And your painting is done with the paint, which is again man-made. Cinema is actually done with little bits of reality. Okay, because it's recorded reality. What happens is that cinema is basically constituted by, shall we say, imprints of reality, and these imprints are all taken by a mechanical device. Okay, so which means that the human intervention in cinema is, the human intervention is only in the matter of assembly. It's basically assembly alone, which almost, let's say, broadly speaking, you will point out differences. It's basically assemblage. Cinema is an assemblage of bits of reality, which is why it's somewhat different from literature. And it's different from painting, it's different from theatre. Okay, theatre you are using actually human beings playing roles, and there's much more of... So the question is, how is one creative in cinema is an issue, okay? Now, so because of this, one of the fundamental things of basis of creating the artistic object, okay? One of the fundamental things is mimesis. You know what the word mimesis means? Mimesis. You know what it means? Mimesis is a Greek term, it means imitation of reality, generally, broadly, imitation of reality. So Western thing is, the Greek notion of art should be an imitation of reality, what you see in the real world. The purpose of art is to imitate the real world, okay? Now, are you sure that all cinema is mimesis? What about fantasy? Would fantasy be mimesis? What do you think Alice in Wonderland is mimesis?
No.
No?
It's not? It's a distortion of reality. It's a distortion of a very, mimesis is a Greek term to depict reality and imitate art,
yeah,
and imitate the world.
Yeah.
Alice in Wonderland is a prime example of creating an alternate universe. It's literally
It's alternative universe, but it's a plausible universe, isn't it? It's plausible, isn't it? See, if it's believable, if it's plausible, if it's believable, what does that make it? Is Kafka, you have you read Kafka?
Yes.
Is Kafka my missus?
Yes. No, I'm the pocket expression in the story. No. But it's not.
It's a distortion. Again, we'll come into this. It's a distortion which seems to heighten reality, right?
Yes.
But isn't that a very subjective way of putting it? We can say it heightens reality, an experience. We can say it's an imagination. When we have these terms.
Okay, if you didn't recognize the truth in Alice in Wonderland.
Isn't that a subjective thing to say to recognize?
No, I'm saying. Look, aren't there such things as valid fantasies and invalid fantasies?
Fantasy itself is a term which is subjective.
No. What I'm saying, see, the question is, all literature is not, this is not a question which I'm putting out to debate. Literature is not arbitrary in the sense that everything is valid, right? Okay, there are certain kinds of fantasies which are valid, certain kinds of fantasies which are not valid, right? Okay, you will have a hierarchical, shall we say, a hierarchical thing of validity, right? So when you say Alice in Wonderland, you recognize a certain truth. So for example, you say, in my world, I have to run 3 times as fast as to stay in the same place. Okay, isn't there a truth in that statement?
There is.
There is, no? If you say it's truth, what is it exactly? What is that truth it contains? Isn't that the truth of experience? What is it? It's recognizable, isn't it? If it's recognizable, isn't it mimesis in some way? It would be, I think. See, the question is metaphor will come in, okay? When you start, the question is metaphor will come in, things will come in. In fact, the whole thing of creativity is how to distort reality to make it truer in some way, right? Make it recognizable in some way, okay? In a way that it's to break the cliche, to show something which seems to be sharper, you're defining reality in a sharper way by distortion. You didn't do that, okay, let's proceed, okay. Mimesis is broadly imitating the imitation of the real world, okay? Now, can you imagine the world, imagine reality being imitated without the presence of an observer? Is it possible, is it necessary to have an observer? You have to be an observer, right? So all mimesis, all imitation of the real world will have to have an observer present in some way, correct? Okay? So, in other words, what you are saying is, the subjectivity of the observer is included in mimesis in some way. Also, the internal world of the observer. And why? What is the internal world of the observer? What is the internal world of the observer? Is it your personal world? Is it your personal world?
To a large extent, it is. It's your perception.
Yeah, but are you going to, you would make a distinction, okay, when you're producing art. You would make a distinction between what is entirely your own and what you share with other people, right? Okay? So the question is, when you say internal world of somebody, when you say the internal world of the spectator, the artist or whatever, it's not your personal fears, right? In fact, this is one of the things you understand when we talk about Hitchcock and all this, when we talk about people, artists like that. They talk in terms of Hitchcock's castration complex and this sort of stuff. Now the question is, okay, these are not things which should be put in. Okay, there are, like, for example, I don't put my complexes into my movies. In fact, it's the same thing with writing. Okay, you don't reveal yourself in your writing. You hide yourself in your writing. Okay, you hide yourself in your cinema. You don't reveal yourself in your cinema. Now, so therefore, when you do imitation, okay, it must necessarily be selective. Okay, you have to distort reality in some way. You have to distort reality in some way. Okay, you must have a perspective on the world. Okay, there's a perspective that you have to have on the world, and then you must allow for subjectivity. You cannot imagine a film or a novel or anything without having some element of subjectivity in it. Okay, has to be there. So then. Cinema then, okay, does not try to attain truths, okay, but as much as putting forth a plausible and interesting viewpoint, it must be recognizable in some way. I mean, when we say truths, again, we are coming, they're not so much truths as experience, okay, and this thing will come in useful later. They're not abstractions, truths or abstractions,
but they are, how do you put it, they are recognizable components of experience, right? Is there any doubt on this part? Alice in Wonderland, you wouldn't say they are truths, we call them truths. No, they are not truths. But when you say I must run 3 times as fast to stay in the same place, it's a component of experience. Okay? Kafka's Metamorphosis, the hunger artist. Kafka's the hunger artist. You read the hunger artist. Why? I don't know. I've read it 20 times. I don't know what to make of the story. I mean, except it's extremely easy to read. You can't even say there's a truth in that story. You can't even say it's a truth, but it's recognizable in some way as some component of experience. If you actually tie it down to a truth, it will probably lose value in some way, alright? So then, there are two aspects of cinema is mimesis, which is first catch those aspects of reality which are pertinent or typical. This is very important, that what you catch in cinema, whatever you catch, has to be pertinent, it has to be typical in some way. When I say typical, you must recognize it as part of common experience. And you have the capacity to leave out those things which you think are completely personal. Completely personal things. Would you make a distinction? What wouldn't you include, if you have a hatred of the opposite sex, if you have a hatred of dogs, if you have a hatred of high places, if you have something like this, you would know that these are personal, right, of some sort, okay? These are very personal things which have no universal validity, right? So you are basically looking into those aspects which you think are commonly valid among various people. So you would look for the typical, you would look for things which are commonly held. Okay, it has to be pertinent or typical. And basically in this particular thing, you are positing an audience of some sort. So this thing of not making films for an audience is fallacious. You have to make films for an audience. But the question is, how do you decide what kind of audience? See, everybody wants an audience, everybody wants a spectator, okay? But the question is, how do you define a spectator? What kind of spectator are you looking for, okay? You have something called like-minded people. You have a kind of category of people. There is this, you imagine your friends, okay? You imagine your friends, you have a group of people. You, without imagining them, you can't write. You are actually addressing somebody. You are addressing somebody. And this somebody will be people you know in some way, right? So that audience is always imagined in something. It's not correct to say that I don't make films for an audience, I make it for myself. I write only for myself. It's not true. You are writing for some friends, you are writing for some people. But the question is, you are not targeting it at, all people. You're not looking for a sizable audience to make your film viable. Let's say, you're not doing that. But you're basically imagining an audience of some sort. Unless you have an audience of some sort which shares your vision, okay? Or rather, not shares your vision, which you feel will be interested in what you have to say, okay? And you won't be able to make a film, or you won't be able to do anything. Okay, that's the first thing. And the second thing is distorted in a way that it is your view as a perceiving human being, and people will be able to see the distortion and understand that distortion. What is the purpose of distortion? What is the purpose of distortion? Why does one distort when you catch the reality? Why does one distort it?
I think in cinema, if you want to convey the same meaning, what you thought, I think we need to distort it. You show as it is. It may not convey the same thing that you want to show. In order to say what you want to say, you need to distort.
Yeah, in other words, you're giving an intensity, emphasis in certain ways, right? Yeah. It's a certain thing of you catch an experience in some particular way, you'll have to distort it. Yeah. Otherwise, that experience, that it won't get that intensity, it won't get that, it won't get the emphasis that you want, okay? For which case, I'll try to show you a little segment of a film, where this question of distortion, how it comes very gently, how it can be brought into a film. We will talk about that later. So that basic thing of distortion is required, okay? Now, so any film should lie between capturing reality. Capturing reality is generally realism. Now, realism is broadly at one extreme of, it's not possible to have this extreme of realism, because the realism would be, by its definition, would be completely unselective. But at one extreme, it will be just a frame around a reality which is ongoing. that would be realism. The other side, you have expressionism, which is completely distorted. Okay? And all films would lie somewhere between realism on one side and an expression on the other side, right? So this is the basic thing. So what is this thing you are trying to do? You are trying to look at experience. The basic thing is observation. You look at observation in some way, requires some study, observation. And observation, you are recognizing a certain aspect of observation and you are giving it more color, giving it more emphasis, giving it more intensity by distorting it a little. Now, when the word expressionism in cinema is usually associated with German expressionism, right? Now, don't be confused by that. That's a very specific movement, okay? That's only one extreme form of thing. What are the various tools by which you do express yourself in cinema? One would be montage, which is editing, right? Which is editing. The other thing is what you call mise-en-scène, which is basically set design, stage design, location, that kind of thing would be mise-en-scène, okay? So these two things, how do you pick locations? Breathe ordinariness, which is completely different, okay? From being an ordinary house, you get the difference. So you want to say that he's ordinary, that ordinariness has to be highlighted in some very special way. The banality of that ordinariness of a certain kind of existence will have to be like, what is that, Eliot's two lines from Eliot, no one came and no one went, he took in the milk and paid the rent. I mean, this kind of stuff, okay. If you don't have it in poetry, nobody came, he just went and paid the rent, it's not ordinary. To make it ordinary, it has to be put in poetry, it has to be done, you have to highlight it in something, okay. Any issues up to this point? So basically, what are you doing? And you have to put in your inner world. That basic thing of inner world of some sort. Now, all films are not bicycle thief. Does it have an inner world of some sort? Everybody would have seen Bicycle Thief. Does it have? I don't think there's any inner world in Bicycle Thief. Is there? It's between. Now, Bicycle Thief and Pathar Panchali, which has got more elements of it? No. I think that the subjective viewpoint in Pathar Panchali is a stronger subjective viewpoint. It doesn't mean that Pathar Panchali is a better film than Bicycle Thief. But there are different levels of inner worlds. But the inner world is something which some people are more predisposed towards. And it would certainly help too. You have to think about how you're going to do it. I mean, it's certainly probably through the character, through a certain thing, okay? Okay, now we'll come to Indian cinema. Okay, now the basic thing about Indian cinema, as distinct from whatever I've said so far, is that Indian cinema did not begin as documentary, okay? It began as the mythological, okay? The Palke made this film mythological. Now it's very interesting that Phalke should make this mythological film. What does it tell you? And Phalke believed that his films were realistic. He said his films were realistic because Rama, Krishna were not unreal. Okay? They were all part of a certain reality, but they were not the reality you were seeing. Okay? So which means this is the thing of reality again, which is transcends the notion of is as of experienced reality. It goes beyond the empirical thing of reality to something else. It is something known to be true rather than experienced. Okay? Now they are completely different things. It's not necessarily, I'll try to make this point. It's not necessarily to do with gods themselves. But his basic thing was that they were known truths and they were known truths which were known from tradition, was his basic thing. Okay? The gods were real, the Puranas, nobody is going to agree that Ravi Verma, I mean you'd be to cosmopolitan bunch of atheists and agnostics, it may be okay to talk about, to laugh at the Puranas. But to a large number of people, especially common audiences, they are not unreal. Okay? So the question is that when, and that too, in the colonial era, when you are basically fighting colonial imperialism, when you are fighting some other religion, you are fighting all this, it would seem that it's more true, should be more true than, see, like, there are so many things, there are so many political beliefs that we cling to as true, right? Okay, they are not, they are disputable, but we cling to them. I mean, my iconic figures, who do you regard as an iconic figure? No, those are all, all part of the process of myth making somehow. But reality is completely contaminated by myths, so it's very difficult to say where, what is the myth and what is reality, right? So the question is that Palki's films were realistic in some way. See, believe they were realistic, okay? Now, after Palki, the Puranas, told truth, these are basic things, okay? After Palki, moved on to the mythological, but this is the basic difference. Indian cinema has been adopting the Puranic worldview. This is the fundamental thing, which is why Indian cinema, popular cinema has been going on this Puranic worldview, which is why all the action, takes place at the heroic level. Can you tell me any one fundamental camera narrational difference between Hindi movie and have you ever come across a Hitchcock type of movie in Hindi cinema, popular cinema? Have you seen Rear Window? Vertigo, have you seen? What is it that Vertigo has, some element that Vertigo has or Rear Window has? Very key component of Vertigo or Rear Window, which you will never find in a popular film.
From the perspective of the observer being the character, I don't see the
point of view. Okay, the point is that certain things, certain information is available only to certain people. It is not available to other people in the things, which means that certain people are excluded from the information in the thing. That there is point of view. So what happens is when you're using mimesis, what happens in mimesis is that since all truths, the observer is a key component of mimesis, all truths are only subjective truths in some sense. Okay, there'll have to be some point of view on this. So it will be character point of view. It will be something as seen by somebody, right? Now you will not come across in a Hindi movie any such thing as an individual point of view. It's never, you've seen this famous scene from Psycho where Marion Crane goes into Norman Bates' office. And you have those birds sitting there, right? Now you have this composition, black, it's completely chiaroscuro lighting and all that. It's extremely sinister. Now what exactly is that? Why is it so sinister? Is it the way Norman Bates saw it? It can't be, right? Because it's Norman Bates' office. So this basic thing of expressionist lighting, black and white, okay, black and white in this very sharply contrasted way, in this very sinister way, is basically, okay, is basically a thing of subjectivity, of Marion Crane's subjectivity when placed in a certain situation. This is basically it. So when that's a certain distortion, when you have this kind of, it's a certain kind of distortion. Now in Hindi cinema, V.K. Murthy did some kind of camera work like this for in Pyasa and this. But where is the subjectivity in that film? Where is the subjectivity in Pyasa? Where is the subjectivity in Kaagaz Ke Phool? I mean, does it merit that kind of camera work? What is, because the people praise this V.K. Murthy's work in this Kaagaz Ke Phool. But I'm just asking a simple question. Shouldn't there be a subjectivity in the narration for the film to use this kind of camera work in this kind of lighting? I leave it to you. You think about it. Is it the viewpoint of that director? It's not, I don't think so. It's not the viewpoint of the hero because he dies and it's not... You don't get it from his viewpoint. He's just a character in the film. There is no viewpoint there. So subjectivity is not there. Hindi cinema doesn't have this notion of subjectivity at all. Because it's Puranic, right? Everything is taking place at the, at some exalted level that you're seeing, like you're looking at the gods. You're looking at everything at that level. There cannot be subjectivities in any way. Okay? Any issues with this? No? Okay. Since you've been raising a lot of questions, I can believe that there are no issues. Okay. So then, this the fact that it doesn't allow for a subjective, no point of view. The camera eye is omniscient. Okay. And when you say the camera eye is omniscient, what you see in the film is all there is to the world. See, one basic thing is Hindi cinema fantasy, Let me ask you. Is Hindi cinema fantasy?
To me, yes.
Popular cinema? No, not to me. I'm just asking that. Don't qualify. Is it fantasy? Is popular cinema fantasy?
It's most of
the... No, it's not. See, I'll tell you why. It is fantasy, okay? Fantasy can only exist, okay, when reality is an alternative. Real and fantastic,
yes.
Okay? They have to be alternatives. When you look at, there's this man called Todorov, like you might have heard of this guy, Todorov, Bulgarian theorist, literary theorist, who made a categorization of fantasy into three categories. One he called fantastic, okay? And the thing is, fantastic means that the spectator, the reader, hesitates between a real explanation and a fantastic explanation. Okay? So, Dracula comes there and they see Dracula and some signs are there. If the final explanation is fantastic, it's a fantasy. So, a Dracula thing would be fantastic in the sense that they hesitate in their mind, the reader hesitate, could be possible. It's a ghost, in a ghost story. People don't believe that there's a ghost. What is this? My God, I can't believe it, right? So then they gradually convince that there's a supernatural explanation. That is called fantastic. There's a second category called uncanny, in which the final effect is to give a rational interpretation. Some Sherlock Holmes stories, the Sussex vampire, you come across this. What is the initial thing which is, the explanation which is proposed is basically fantastic, there's a vampire. But it is dumped and then they finally hit upon a what comes to is a rational. Like this is called uncanny. The third category is called marvelous. It's called marvelous. Third category is called marvelous, and that category is to create an alternative world which works completely by alternative things. Like for example, Alice in Wonderland would be marvelous. Okay, Lord of the Rings would be marvelous. Okay. These would be marvelous. In India, what would be marvelous? Not by Palki's definitions, by our definitions. What?
Songs
and ice. No, what would be marvelous? It is not the real and alternative world. So you will take your mythologicals as marvelous in some way. Again, you have to see the difference between a mainstream Hindi movie and something like the Ramsey Brothers. Ramsey Brothers are fantastic. Okay? Purana, Mandir, okay? All those would be fantastic because there is a certain disbelief initially that this shaitan is actually woken up, and that disbelief marks it as, it's very very strange that the Indian horror film is fantastic, the Pakistani horror film is uncanny. It's very very, the Pakistani horror film is very interesting to watch. There are some two or three available. It's very interesting to watch these Pakistani horror movies. What exactly? I think it's Maula Jat, I think. You know that. What is it? Maula Jat. Have you seen Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
Yes.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre. There is this chap with this leather face. This Maula Jat, there is the killer equivalent. Guess what is that person's attire? It's a burqa. The person with the burqa is going around wielding. I mean, you see, this is not possible in India. It's not possible to make a movie like this in India, okay? It's a very subversive category. Horror movies are subversive in some way. Okay, let's not go into that. So anyway, Hindi cinema is not this. Hindi cinema does not tell you it's an alternative world because Hindi cinema has messages all the time. Okay? They're giving you the truth. Hindi cinema always gives you the truth. Hindi cinema will not give you reality, it will give you the truth. Okay? There is no popular film which doesn't give you the truth, okay? So then the question is that these are transcendental truths, just as what is his name, Palke thought, they believed that the Rama and Krishna of his films were transcendental, they were truths and they were real in some way. But Hindi cinema has a sort of reality, it's talking about reality, a certain sort of reality, not empirical reality. Okay, not empirical reality, but a certain transcendental reality which goes beyond, which is why Hindi cinemas always have these truths. Give example, all of them. The basic thing is to have a trajectory. You follow somebody's young lease.
So, because Indian cinema keeps trying to give us the truth or their version of the truth, and
yeah.
we end up believing it.
Yeah.
So aren't we, don't we end up believing in an irrational explanation, and hence it's a fantastical.
No. These are not even. These are not. They don't try to persuade you. Hindi cinema doesn't try to. These are truths which you already know. It's already known to you that if you study hard, you do well, and you. It's already known to you that wicked people will not wear spectacles. It's already known to you that terminally ill people cannot be wicked. It's known to you. I mean, you understand what I mean? See, like there are certain things that Hindi cinema will not allow. It will not allow a wicked man to have spectacles. It will not allow a terminally ill man to be wicked. It will not allow certain things. Hindi cinema will insist on certain representations, right? Now, if you didn't recognize these representations or somehow truth, right? See, disregard empirical reality, disregard empirical experience, disregard experience, okay? Do you or don't you have an idea of spectacles meaning something in themselves?
Yeah.
Scholarship, right? Okay? Now, the question is, it's your rational self which makes you reject that explanation. But spectacles, if you ask a child to draw somebody with spectacles, he will not draw a wicked man with spectacles, right? Will a child draw a wicked man with spectacles? No. It will be a doctor, it will be a professor, it will be a dentist. Okay, it will not be a wicked man. It will not be a smuggler. You can imagine a smuggler having spectacles. No. Smugglers don't. So it's a truth, right? Yeah. I wouldn't call it rational self, it's your educated self which rejects it.
I know which makes no,
no.
We reject it and then the movie makes
no, the movie, movie is giving
it. He tries to make us believe that Salman can get
it. He doesn't believe it. It's just no, we don't believe it. It's a compact. What is the word I would use? It's simply an agreement between you and the film.
Yeah.
You're not going to carry it on, right? It's an agreement between you and the film that a wicked man will not wear spectacles. That a man when he comes out of jail will have a beard. It's an agreement between you and the film, right? Okay? You're not going to go. When a person you see me, you don't think I came out of jail, right? There's an agreement, right? This agreement which is film, but these are not, there's nothing to do with reality. It is not fantasy, it is not marvelous. They're dealing with the real world, they're dealing with certain truths about the real world, which are accepted a priori, right? Which you are required to what is it called? Not swallow. I will say you are required to
recognize.
You are recognized to accept. Let's say. You are within 3 hours or 4 hours, then you are required to accept this. Okay? Now, this is the novel. When you are writing a novel, you can't write a novel on these lines. A novel belongs to a different thing. You are going to write a comic, a marchitra kata, you are going to draw, you are going to use this. Right? You're going to use that fellow, what's his name, this new guy who's writing some Ikshwaku, who's this chap? I'm sure he uses some Amish Tripathi. You heard of Amish Tripathi? I don't know, I'm not, but maybe he's probably using this kind of thing, okay? Bearded people coming out of jail probably, I mean, you know, this is the kind of stuff, okay? So this is the thing that these chaps would do. Now, so the question is, these are representations the popular film does. It works within a certain thing, okay? The thing is, this message usually in Hindi cinema, the modern, well, it's popular cinema, is you follow the trajectory of the protagonist. Whatever he goes through becomes illustrative in some way of whatever. Now, the problem for you is that art cinema does the same thing. This is a problem, okay? Indian art cinema seems to start off with a message. It starts off with the truth. Now, this is a fundamental thing. Art cinema is supposed to be, it's about ordinary people, right? Art cinema deals with ordinary people. It deals with people who are leading ordinary lives. They're not heroic, they go through ordinary things, their families are in disarray, their children are not studying properly, or they're not able to study properly, the next meal is going to come from, is a problem, okay? So these are basic fundamental issues of the art film, and one of the things, it comes from novels. Art film is basically from the novel category. It doesn't mean that they are conceived as novels in some way, as different from conceived as an epic or a Quran. If you've read, if you've seen Three Idiots and you've seen that fellow's book, Chetan Bhagat's book, you'll know they're completely different. They've completely transformed the book into making it into some kind of epic kind of thing. The book is not like that at all, okay? So then, but the thing is, in art cinema, okay, the problem with art cinema in India is it peddles truths, okay? This is a big problem. It's always going beyond reality, it's going beyond this and giving messages. And these messages are not Puranic messages. They are not that person, they are not the kind of messages which popular cinema gives you. Popular cinema's truths are all Puranic truths, they would believe. These things are truths from Marxism, be truths from feminism, there'll be truths from some religious thing, like GIR would be some religious truths of some sort. Or what you call moral truths, of some moral, when we say not the moral truths of the Puranas, the moral truths of democratic liberalism. Okay? So these are the basic secularism, democratic liberalism, these are the truths. But they are still truths. Okay, they are in the same mythological, they are in the same category as a mythological, except that their truths are not derived, that they are derived from the modern Indian state, modern Indian Republic. Which is why they are basically, I usually ask this question, what is the, who is the, all film, cinemas must have constituencies, right? So they must address a certain public, right? What is the public that Hindi cinema addresses? Indians, right? A certain class of Indians, increasingly in the metropolises. But by and large, the concerns of the thing of the national concerns. You could say Kannada cinema is whatever is the region, in the Kannada language region. What is the constituency of Indian art cinema? What is who does Indian art cinema address?
Middle class.
Sorry? Middle class or lower middle class. No, it addresses the state. See, Indian art cinema addresses the state. All the things the state is unable to attend to, okay, by proxy, it will reward art cinema for showing the same concerns. So basically that. At some point, this is basically it, okay? So this is the basic thing that art cinema has been doing this. You could call them the new messages which are meant for democratic, secular, liberal India. They're meant for that. So these are the things which are basically part of the art cinema. And my point is that when you deal with this, okay, observational detail is neglected. In Harimu, for instance, I'll just give you, but not at Harimu's episode, I just happened to see it recently, that you have the sense of two different patients coming to a hospital. One is a person who's a journalist's father, who's reasonably well off, not badly off, he has a car or whatever. The other person is some rustic person who has no money at all. Both of them come to the same hospital. Is it possible in real life for a rustic to come to a real hospital, to the kind of same hospital? Don't we know, all of us know, okay, all of us know how the medical treatment is, how we respond to medical treatment, how the private nursing is, how Victoria Hospital is, okay? Now he said he had some problems with getting locations, but that's not it. Which means it doesn't matter to you what locations are, because your idea is more important. You have this thing of, you know, the father something, you have to have this thing of father, filial love or whatever as a fundamental concern that you have. And to convey that message, you are prepared to overlook, shall we say, experience. You are prepared to overlook factual detail which you want to see. So this is the general thing. And one question, I'll end this with a question. What do you think of Anurag Kashyap's films? Something like Rangdev, what is that film called? Gangs of Wasseypur. What do you think of that? What is the idea of reality? It's sort of, it's very confusing, right? I don't know what to make it. Is it realism? What exactly is Anurag Kashyap? Just a question. What do you think?
I think it's the same as like what you're talking about is not fitting any kind of fantasy. But because it's not the same as the other Indian cinema we've seen, it's just a deviation, but it still doesn't, it's not fantastic.
It's not fantastic.
It's not uncanny. Maybe there are exceptions where it's uncanny in parts, not the entire movie.
You know, when things are shot on location, it's really difficult for us to have, especially grimy locations, okay? I would look upon him as this, one of the offsprings of Slumdog Millionaire, okay? That grimy, you know, grimy India, this kind of, but I can't really, you know, I can't place his films as realistic or not. Then finally it occurred to me, have you seen his use of music? There is music all the time in the soundtrack, okay? There's not a single still moment in the film. There's always something going on, either there's some noise going on, there'll be music. Have you seen Queen? Queen, when he goes to, the same problem, when you go to Paris,
You have some crooning Hindustani kind of stuff, okay, some ghazal stuff going on. Why is he doing this? It's basically creating a certain mood to work against the thing of reality, right? To suppress reality. I think what is happening is that the visuals are real, the soundtrack is not real. This is a big thing, that soundtrack is being used to pacify in some way. I don't know if I'm making sense. It's sort of a way of pacifying reality in some way. It's sort of making it palatable, it's sort of sugarcoating reality. The reality itself, you have fingers and this lying all over the place. The very fact that dead bodies and fingers and all lying all over the place and people being shot to death in every 2 minutes. That crooning music or whatever is the soundtrack, you know, it's very... Hindi films, as they've become more and more real, they've also become noisier and noisier in terms of music. It's no longer restricted to songs. Nobody sings songs except performances. Okay? The songs are actually heard in the soundtrack, and the soundtrack itself submerges. It submerges real sounds. It has this way of cutting out real sounds. Side element, all of us have a certain element of dread when you go to an unknown place, when you go to a foreign location. And if this woman had that been subjectivity, then this woman should have had some dread. Okay? Here he sort of comforts everybody, including the audience, by putting Hindi music on the soundtrack in Paris. So I think it's basically a kind of pacifying. So whatever you may actually see in the movie, it's basically benign because it's pacified by the music. Okay? I think I'll stop here.